lovely to see you all here tonight at the Camelia Grove, the Cammy. Thank you to Tracy and the absent Jamie for putting on this hotel here for us. Thank you very much. Now, my job. My name's John Kerr. I'm doing a locum for Connor Court, the publishers of Gambling for Love by John Killick. Gambling for Love is $29.95, and although John is the first bank robber of the new decimal currency, he kept some sixpences back from the old days, and if you give us $30, we'll give you a sixpence back. To get books, you go up here and John will sign them. The books are also $25 if you buy three, so if you can think of three people to give it to at Christmas time, he'll autograph it to them, and you'll get the $5 discount. No sixpence. Okay, the main reason why John is famous is because he escaped from Silverwater Jail in a helicopter. And I wasn't there at the time, but I've been over the footage a fair bit. But this, I think, is more meaningful. I got a letter from a guy who was in there, nice Chinese bloke whose name I don't know, except that his writing alias and calligraphy name is Ling Hao. And he was in there and he wrote this about the helicopter liftout. I've experienced a lot in my life, but there are three things in particular I'll never forget. The first is climbing Wai Tai Mountain in 1986 to meet and pay respects to the Buddhist master, Ring Xiaoping. The second is the student demonstrations of 1989 in Beijing, my hometown, when I climbed on the eastern viewing platform in Tiananmen and looked down from the rostrum at more than a million people gathered in the square. I wondered what Mao Zedong felt standing at that same position on the 1st of October 1949 when he declared the founding of the People's Republic of China. The third was witnessing the helicopter escape of a prisoner from Silverwater Metropolitan Remand and Reception Centre in Sydney. An incredibly joyous and satisfying experience. And I'd like now to introduce the man that's going to launch this, the one and only Bob Ellis.
For a while, it seemed that John, not Ronald Ryan, would be the last man hanged in Victoria. He had bashed in the head of John de Boer, a guard he liked, in the cause of a stuffed-up great escape with an iron bar. And he hovered near death, and then was reported to have died. And, uh-oh, John said, not for the first time in his life. And he thought, oh well, death at 27 is preferable to how I live now, enslaved, shamed, beaten by corrupt, sadistic police. In a place of engrimed humiliation, not much better than it was when, within the same walls, Ned Kelly hanged and the Toll Puddle martyrs did their time. This is a well-written book, one cannot put down, any page of which could be a French novella, unflinching, violent, honest, in the moment, like something by Camus or Hemingway or Mailer or Hugo. But it poses difficult questions, all of which begin with the words, what if? What if John's mother had not suicided when he was 17? What if she had not been driven to it by her drunken, abusive husband, whom John throughout the book both loves and hates and cannot live with more than a few days, and treasures the letters of? What if he had not met Kathy? What if she had not gone in her teens with her family to America? What if he had not determined to follow her there with a forged visa and a swag of money he hoped to accumulate with a short, sharp bank robbery? What if he had not quit out of restless boredom, a dozen dreary jobs, and stayed out of trouble? Does he have attention deficit disorder or simply a traumatized adolescent. Would it have been a better life if he had persisted at tennis, then thought a pansy's game, gone the extra mile at that, or at running, at which he was astonishingly good, outrunning armed bank tellers and police more than once? Would it have been better if he had not run out of petrol that time and been seen by police stealing more? It would have been better, of course, if he had got the intermediate certificate in the same year I did, 1956, and gone, like me, to the Sydney University of Clive James, Michael Kirby and Robert Hughes. Is there a doom in some suburbs of the working class that prohibits this ascent? Or is it a question of character? I'm not sure I know what character is. I know what circumstance is. And were this a wartime book, John might have been a true hero in it, like Douglas Bader or Richard Pape. Perhaps he needed a war to prove himself in, and not the New South Wales and Victorian prison systems, lately erupting over cigarettes in a riot and a lockdown he could imagine and sympathise with now, and write about now. He was a warrior without a war, and so it goes. There will be bad reviews of this book, not by those who abhor its violence, for that in a way is fair game, but by those feminists and those male feminists who rightly feel he treated his women badly, the women he used while dreaming of Kathy overseas. It is remarkable he is only 31 at the end of it. He seems to have gone on a journey as long as Odysseus, through chapters of hell that Dante might in verse have evoked almost as eloquently as John does here. I see in this book direct proof of how hard redemption is these days. John could leave a job and get another in the neighbourhood, in the district, 2 days later. Today you would have great difficulty in 6 months finding anything, except of course in petty crime, drug dealing, rolling drunks, or with his learning prevailing in one or another quiz show on Channel 9. In his day, you paid your debt to society and could be employed again on your release. In the present day, this is not so. And we are daily assailed by the glorious fortunes of billionaires and invited into larger crime to emulate them. No more the suburban bank job. It's the corporate takeover now by crooks with Harvard degrees and the shifting of income round global enterprises like Alan Bonds or Murdoch. And there is little opportunity beyond the smashing in of the odd ATM for a man like John to make his way in the world. At one point, holding a gun, he asked to be flown to Cuba, and he would have done well there. He would, but for a couple of personal tragedies, have done well here too, in a Whitlam era that lasted and paid him through university. Well, had better timing, had he not run out of petrol after a heist and chosen a few less dumb clucks as his accomplices. This is an astonishing book, and will, I think, become a classic available to readers of all pedigrees and backgrounds, and eloquent, stirringly eloquent, of the human spirit at the end of its tether. And I hereby declare it launched.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, the author. It's very hard to say much after that elegant speech. And I haven't really prepared, but I would say this, that anyone who reads the book, I know that you'll enjoy it. You might get angry, you might get frustrated, you might say, what the hell is he doing? But I think that you'll identify with me, because that's what we do when we read books. We tend to identify with the main character, unless he's evil, or somebody is despicable. Otherwise, we've got that tendency, as the book goes on, to actually identify with the main character. And if you identify with me, you're going on a real roller coaster ride. And there's a lot of ups, there's a lot of downs. And you'll say, you shouldn't, don't do that, don't do that. But I'll go ahead and do it. And particularly as a gambler, when, you know, that was really pivotal, and Naomi realised that gambling was where it was at. It virtually, very nearly destroyed me. It hasn't destroyed me, but it very nearly did. And nearly destroyed people around me. And I've seen it happen not just with people like me, but a lot of other people from all walks of life. You can be a bank manager, you can be you can be a bank robber, but the same thing's going to happen. You can have a lot of money, or access to a lot of money. You're going to lose it eventually, gambling. Unless one of those geniuses, and there are a few, who can win at the game. And some people can gamble, and they've got breaks. Most people have got breaks. I didn't have any breaks. If I lost, I'd chase it. It's in my nature, and you've got to understand your nature. And my nature was such that if I was losing, it didn't matter what it was. It was tennis, anything I did, I'd throw everything out and try and win. Didn't matter how far down I was. And it was the same with gambling. That if I was losing really bad, I'd throw everything in the pot, try and get it all back in one go. It's a bad way to gamble. I was a bad gambler. I didn't learn because I had a big ego. And that comes out in the book. If you've got a big ego, you think, look, you know, I'm smarter than everybody else. I can figure out ways to win. I study for 50 hours a week on horses. I should be able to win. It gives me an advantage. And that's what I did. But I didn't account for pulling the horses up, for the horses getting trapped, the horses having off days, bad tracks, all sorts of things. That in the end, you see the bookmakers always going home in big cars, and you walking home. And it took me a long time to realise it. It took me to the end of the last century to realise it. But I can say now that for most people, you shouldn't gamble. If you do gamble, if you can control it, that's fine. But if you're one of those people who's got that addictive nature, where you want to chase it or keep gambling and get that kick, it can lead to bad things and can lead to crime. And even the best of people can turn to crime. And I've seen it happen. Good people, I've seen a lot of good people in jail. And I would say this, that you gamble, you chase it, you lose, you go to crime, you go to jail. You go to jail, you'll never be the same again. You'll come out worse than when you went in. Jail is not the place to be. It's destructive. And there are a lot of things that can happen to you in jail, and quite often do. Some people don't even come out of jail. And it's very few people come out better. And the only reason I've come out better is because I age, and a constant bashing the head against the wall made me stop and realise 10, 12 years ago that, you know, I haven't got long left, what am I going to do? And from that time, I did some gambling courses, and I worked at a violent prevention thing. We worked with psychs, and I say this for the corrective service, I've been, you know, I don't know if it's the same day later, but I will say that they've got this program, the violent prevention thing, which I think is very good program. It's a deal on the crown. The people who work there, most of them who come through it and do it, you see that they do not revert back to crime. They do not go back to gambling. There's a lot of money, there's a lot of psychs, and it's hard work, and there should be more programs like that in prisons. And I think it's the only way. With our prison population at the moment, we've got 11,500 in New South Wales, rapidly rising because of new bail laws. And there was, 18 months ago, it was 9,500. There's not enough programs in jail. There's overcrowding in jail. This can only lead to more crime. And at the end, we talk about public interest. The public interest should be in getting people out of jail and having them rehabilitated. And it's not going to happen the way the system's going, the way the system's going backwards. I say that because I see it and I know what's going on. And I've experienced enough to see it. Then you say, well, how come you were in that system and come out? And I say, well, because I did those programs, because I got older, and because in the end, and I say it, it's not just a crime for anything that you're addicted to, or that you've got a habit of doing bad things, that the only person really can change is you. You've got to make that decision. You've got to be the one to say, I'm going to change, I'm not going to go that way anymore. And you look around and say, well, look what it's done. And if you're smart enough, and you've got the intelligence and the logic, and you can see what it's done, and the people that are around you that are hurt, then if you've got any decency, you've got to come good and try and redeem yourself and redeem the people around you. And that's what I'm trying to do. A lot of people say, oh, it's too late, look what you've done. I always say, well, I haven't done it this century. And that's true. I haven't done it this century, and I continue that way. And eventually, when the second book comes out, you'll see that it'll be a ripper of your own, but I really would recommend that everybody try and get a copy of this book and read it, because it's a hell of a journey, and it's true. I've got almost photographic memory on dates, and it's chronologically correct. And, you know, if anybody buys that book and finds anything wrong chronologically, I'll hand them the money back. And that's a guarantee that I'll give them. So I just hope that you get the book and read it and enjoy it. Thank you.
Usually when I talk to John, I had to sit in the maximum security visitor's room at Goulburn. And I'd look around and I'd think, that guy looks a bit familiar. And then John would come in and say, hi, Ivan. And that was who he was, same way. Right? John would come in and he'd say to the bloke that I was looking at that I thought was a bit familiar, hello, Ivan. And it was the right one. And it was a pretty grim place. So I'm really pleased to see him around here. And now I'm going to introduce Professor Ian Plimer, who's been writing to John for many years, for the 15 years, for the half Mandela that this man has just completed in jail. And we're taking questions about John's character, experience, or anything else you'd like to know, and that includes Bob Ellis. So let's know your questions. I'll start off with one.
If you were going to go for a cash armed robbery, where would you go today?
Probably Ian's place. The dog would lick you to death.
Okay, well, if anybody wants to ask any questions, I'm certainly prepared to answer them. And same as Professor, he's written many books himself, so.
Hi, John.
Yeah,
out of
bed. Yeah,
hi, Ian. How old were you when you first had your first bet?
First bet? It was 1956, Caulfield Cup, so I was 14.
That was bet, not bed.
Oh, yeah, that was bet, not bed, wasn't it?
So how old were you, 14?
I was 14 and it won, came from last. Yeah, carried 9 stone 13, come from last, and I got hooked.
Red Crows.
Sorry,
I was born in 64, but I've read up on it.
I know you have. You're pretty good.
Yeah, Red Crows. What are you on Arthur Ward on?
It was Arthur Ward, yeah.
So and you continued to gamble from that day on?
Well, yeah, and I won. You know, I won for a while. And the next three bets I had all won, and I said, how long has this been going on? And for a while, I wasn't addicted. I'd play tennis and I used to put a few bets on a bookmaker and go play tennis and I'd go and get the results later. And, I bet, within my means at first, but when I hit my 20s is when I got out of control. Yeah.
What does it feel like to rob a bank? How do you feel?
Well, most accounts of bank robbers I've read about robbing banks have all said it was adrenaline high and I'm hyped up and, you know, they just got off on it. I was terrified. I'd worry all night before it because I knew this could be the enemy. But when I went in there, I'd psyched myself. So I knew I had to go in there, I had to have control, and so I'd be psyched. And I think that this is it. I think we've all got that capability. I think we've all got two sides to us. And I was able to summon that other side to me in instances like that. And in really hard times, I was able to summon that other side. And I think most people get through life where that other side of them doesn't come out too often.
John?
Does every gambler believe that God is on his side in some way? And did you believe that?
I always thought God was on my side. That's why I'd blame him sometimes when I lost. You know, but they only just got beat most of the time, so I always thought I'd have another go. But yeah, the gamblers do think that they've been gifted with a lucky streak. Most gamblers.
What are your lucky numbers?
4 and 8. Yeah, 4 and 8. Gloria knows that because 6 and 9 are really bad.
John, you are the ultimate proof that inmates in our jails can be rehabilitated, given the right support, but of course also, as you said yourself, given the will on the part of the inmate. Could you describe to us, though, the ongoing, unqualified, non-judgmental support you've had from Gloria?
Well, you know, without Gloria, I may not have got through. You know, she was there, she sent me money every month. She visited me every month. I rang her and she kept contact with me and my son. And when you're doing a long time like that, it's very hard in Gloria because we'd split up and, you know, I'd for a long time, for nearly 7 years, was writing letters to Lucy every day. And Gloria was also going out to see Lucy. And this is a great example, I think, of character that I wouldn't be able to do it. I wouldn't be capable of that sort of thing. But she did it, and I've always appreciated and trying now to make it up to Gloria in what ways I can. And everybody knows Gloria's who she is, a woman of character, and I don't think that anybody would question that.
Is anyone curious to know how the professor met the bank robber?
I think, John, it was nearly 20 years ago. I had a old school friend, old university friend, who worked for the CES in Manly. And she rang me up once and said, I've got one for you. An interesting character. And I was then the professor and head of earth sciences at the University of Melbourne. I'd written a bestseller, a book on religious fundamentalism called Telling Lies for God, gentle, non-provocative book. And so on my next trip up to Sydney, she introduced us and I thought, well, this bloke's pretty smart. He's quite bright, very articulate. What the hell's happened in his life to have the passage of life that he suffered? And over time, we met a number of times, got to know him a bit better. He was interrupted. Our contact, our eye-to-eye contact was interrupted by just another bank robbery, wasn't it? In Barrel. And we corresponded a lot while he's in jail, and I could see from the way he wrote that he was an outstandingly good writer, and I must have read this book 20 times now. He's a really good writer, and I'll challenge anyone here, if you find a typo, a slab of beer's on me. If you're not a beer drinker, and shame be on you, and then it'll be a wine of your choice. find a typo in this book. He is an outstandingly good writer. He's had very good help from many people, but he writes from the heart. And he writes in a way where this book becomes a rollicking yarn. And that's what the book is. Well before I'd met John, he'd had a number of short stories published. He'd been trained to write, and it shows in the work. And I took a bit of a shine to John. I thought, well, this chap is really intelligent. He just hasn't had the breaks in life. And read the first chapter, and you'll see that. And you wonder, when you finish that book, how he's been able to stand up here in front of people. I mean, he's had everything thrown at him that would crush a mere mortal, and he survived it. And he was talking earlier about character. You could not survive what he's had unless you've got his sort of character. So he impressed me from day one, and for more than 20 years we've kept in good contact. And I promised him, when you're in prison,
6 years ago,
I promised I'd get your book published. Here it is.
I would like to say this, I got one up in the end. We both sent an article in HQ magazine. They published mine and didn't publish his. He never forgave me for that. And I would like to say that when I talk about my writing, that when I was released in 73, which is just after this book was finished, I met Ann Brooksman, Bob Ellis's wife, and she went out of her way to help launch me as a writer and introduced me to a guy called Don Hogg, who was the editor of Man magazine at the time, and which is a very popular magazine, probably the most popular magazine in Australia at the time. And I managed to get three short stories published in it and an article. And then I met Richard Walsh and got stuff done in Nation Review and others, which put me on the way for quite a while. But I couldn't make a lot of money as a writer. In those days, you had to wait weeks to get paid. You'd get $50, and by then I was probably blinded at the tap. So, you know, that's gambling again. But Anne did put me on the way, and I thank you, Anne. I've never forgot it, and I think I mentioned it in the book. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Oh, I can answer that one for him.
Right.
I asked him that one, and he said,
"What do you mean?
Just the ones I got caught for."
What else can you
say? How long did you save your life from crime before you got arrested?
I got caught for the first job. First job I got caught. There's a bloke who was retiring from the armed services squad in New South Wales, and he said, "That Reg Killick, he used to rob a bank a bloody week. He was going all the time. We couldn't catch him, but they got him down in Victoria."
The book is remarkably written, and it's in a kind of chronic present tense, which is so suspenseful, and it's in a way a celebration of human incompetence unlike any other thing. The belated acquisition of accomplices that he barely knows. They run out of petrol, for Christ's sake. And they go, "Oh, this is all right, we'll pull up here, we'll suck some petrol out of the parked suburban car. And with the luck, he must be famous for some police came around the corner and caught them doing this." And the speed with which he sort of, and the hope with which he'd run out of a bank with armed tellers after him, and think, in the firm belief that he could actually get through the next block and to eternal freedom, carrying a few hundred bucks that he didn't realise was the only amount there. And so it's an extraordinarily gifted chronicle of incompetent human effort or heroic.
John, I've got a question. Mark, just when you were talking about different characters in jail, mate, what were some of the
That's a good question, Jamie, because you know, I've just about met anybody who's anybody in jail in the last 50 years. From Darcy Dugan, you know, Bill O'Reilly, I was there when they actually hanged Ronald Ryan, the last guy hanged in Australia. And I've met, as I said, I've met a lot of the bad ones. I met a lot of the...
Kingsgrave slasher
was my mentor, so, you know. And I really liked him. And I stood up for him because, you know, he wanted me to get him a pen friend when I got out of jail, and I tried to get him one, and when she found out it's Kingsgrave slasher, she slapped my face. But I did try. But, you know, I've met deviants, killers, rapists, liars, con men, bank robbers. I've met them all, and I've met a lot of good guys in jail. I've got to tell you that the thing is, and I'll take this to my grave, I said it today, I think 85% of people in jail shouldn't be there. And I really mean that. Yeah. Now, that happened. Well, the other 15%, they've got to be in jail. You just can't get around that. We know that. And that includes me. Yeah, if you're robbing banks and escaping helicopters, you've got to go to jail. You know, you don't get bonds for that. But, look, I meet a lot of kids in there, and I see them come in 3 or 4 times. Some of them think it's just a picnic. Yeah, they come into a place like Nowra, and which is fairly easy, and it's a minimum security, and they come through the gates, and, mate, and they see all their buddies, they run up, come on down, we'll have a puff, and you know, it's just like a reunion, and it doesn't scare them. But a lot of them are hooked on drugs, a lot of them come from dysfunctional families, they never worked, their parents have never worked, and everybody knows these sort of backgrounds. And I've spoken to a lot of these kids and taught them that they're basically good-hearted kids. A lot of the young ones that could easily be saved, and if there was a place for them, you know, to be able to get jobs or to be trained and do programs. There's not enough programs in jail for these people. And so they just go on the treadmill. So when people say, like, lock them up and throw away the key, that might apply to some. But to the majority, it doesn't. And I think that, you know, you've got to realise that a lot of them, if they had a chance, could be decent human beings. And in the public interest, it's in the public interest for those people to be able to be rehabilitated. And I think it could be done.
The public interest,
yeah.
What is it that the notion now that jails are going to be privatised, is there a benefit there for society?
I don't think there is. The first private jail in New South Wales was Journey, which everybody would tell you that was a very good jail. But then you look at Park Lee, they're putting them 3 out themselves. They're putting them 3 out, and they're not. It's illegal what they're doing. And what's the bottom line with privatisation? Is to make a dollar. You've got to make a dollar. Yeah, it is. And
the social benefit is what? That you privatise something that's an institution which goes back centuries. What is it that we need to do to rehabilitate? Are they capable of rehabilitating?
Well, I doubt it, because you look at America, and it's an industry over there, privatisation of jails, so they go out into the desert, they'll build a new jail, privatise it, and all of a sudden they'll fill it up. And they fill it up because suddenly the judges stop giving bail, or they're giving longer sentences, or they're pulling people in for a while.
So is there an inequality in the way that we get inmates from certain states that are
alcoholics
in Western Australia, for example, or whatever it might be in the Northern Territory, as opposed to the
South Eastern
states? There seems to be an inequality
in balance. Well, there's certainly an inequality, there's no doubt. People that are, come from unprivileged backgrounds, but it's particularly so in Indigenous. They represent it's outrageous, the percentage of Indigenous people are in jail.
Have you noticed that?
I've noticed it, and I noticed it when I went to Queensland even more. And I went up to Queensland for 6 months on a 31-year-old charge, and just recently. And I was up there, and I saw it with my own eyes. And most of the pods are full of indigenous young ones. They got nothing to do. They're getting on drugs. They're getting on ice. They get out. They got nothing to do.
Is the importation of drugs into jails really easy?
Well, it seems to be. It's not for me to say how it's getting in or what, but yeah. Yeah, well, I would say that it seems to be, because there's plenty of it in the jails. I think Brett over there runs Justice Action. Brett, you would know more than I would about that.
Well, I think access to drugs is easier for sure, no question about it. Yeah. I reckon just take away cigarettes, I don't know whether people know that. That's going to bring it all on.
Could we have a...
Could we have a vote in the audience of those who approve of the taking away of cigarettes from men who've got almost nothing else in their lives?
What do you want?
A vote. Who approves of the taking away of cigarettes? In favour? Anybody against?
Okay. Yeah, definitely. John, once you graduated from the College of Knowledge, did you find the way you were treated by your parole and all of that fair? I mean, I understand that you had an anklet bracelet for some months.
Well, I found that they're leaving me alone now, but when I first got out, I found it oppressive. You've got to understand that a guy 72 to put an anklet bracelet on after he's done 15 years in jail. He's done all the programs, done it right. They kept him in an extra 2 years, and then they put an anklet bracelet on him at the behest of the commissioner, who didn't even know me. Now, the thing is with an ankle bracelet is that you've got to say 10 days in advance where you're going to be every hour of the day. And there's an example. Professor Evan Plimer was sitting, we were having coffee. He came over from South Australia to see me about the book. We were having coffee, and next thing the phone rang, and they said, "What are you doing? You're not supposed to be where you are." And I was going to get a train from Wilson's Point into town to see my lawyer, Eden Avass, who's here tonight. And what happened is that we were 50 metres away from the train station, like 50 metres across. And I said, "Look, I'm just having a coffee with a friend of mine who's coming from South Australia," and I didn't know he was coming. They said, "Well, you should have told us." I said, "Well, I didn't know he's coming." Now, that's the sort of thing that you've got to deal with. It's almost impossible to say where you're going to be 10 days in advance, 24 hours a day. And so it's not only oppressive, I think it's almost inhuman.
It's a major risk to society, as a 72-year-old.
Yeah, well, that's right. And I haven't done it since last century, And, I just look at it, I just didn't think it was justified, and we challenged it, and the parole board saw fit to take it off. But, there was one Islander, big Islander guy, and they put it on him, and I don't know why they put it on him. He wasn't an armed robber, he wasn't a serious offender, but he did have a bit of a history of violence, and they put it on him, and he sat down, he had to work out where he was going to be for the next 10 days, and after a couple of hours he rang him up and said, "What the fuck, I don't know where I'm going to fucking be tonight," he said. Fuck you fucking man. So he came home and put him back in.
Because not many people realise you have to diarise 10 days in advance.
Yeah, and you've got to say where you're going to be. And Gloria, we've been a supermarket and the thing didn't work properly, did it? And they'd say, "Where are you?" They'd wake me up at 2-3 in the morning, "Where are you?" It's a nightmare, and it originally started to put on sex offenders that were pedophiles, but it extended to serious offenders, but there's some laws that we got now that I think are outrageous. One of them is that when people have served their sentence, a whole sentence, that they put this order on them now and put an electronic bracelet on them, and they get a court order to do it after the sentence is finished.
And I think that, you know, we're stepping back in the dark ages when we start doing things like that.
So regarding rehabilitation, how much encouragement did you have regarding rehabilitating yourself?
Well, I've got to say this, that when I went to this violence prevention thing, I had a lot of encouragement there. It's, as I said, it's a jewel in the crown of the correct
surgery. How far in the sentence was that?
Well, that was a long way into the sentence. I had, 2010 I did it, so I'd been in 11 years at that stage. And up in Orlando, I didn't get much encouragement at all, and the programs were mostly non-existent.
How long does the rehabilitation last for, like a year or so?
Well, I did it a year, and then the funny thing is they throw you back in the main, which usually, I think a lot of the effect of that wears off on a lot of people.
So the rehabilitation's really non-existent?
It's non-existent in maximum security, absolutely. And I think in minimum security, to a degree, in some of the jails, but at doing the lowest at the moment, the people I speak to in there are just saying the programs are virtually becoming non-existent, and it's getting worse, the overcrowding's getting worse, and, you know, there are real problems. With the smoking, you know, being a non-smoker, I used to take offence at being put into cells with smokers who smoked all night, and I always felt that with the smoking thing that they should have had jails for non-smokers, really, or at least cells where they couldn't put you. But what they simply do is say, oh well, we've run out of cells, and they throw them in with you anyway, and there's not a thing you can do about it. Yeah, that's right.
Another thing, sorry John. Your learned friend mentioned how articulate and erudite you are. Do you see your future in educating young children and possible offenders in the future?
Well, you know, I'd like to. Today I walked out of Winnie Station, you know, as a kid there, begging. And, you know, I said, I just looked at him, and I'd actually come out of the bank. But you know, to get some change, and I said, "You're a bit young to be begging, aren't you?" And he said, "Oh, my dad's kicked me out, and I'm on unemployment. And I haven't got where to live." So I gave him $5, you know, and I said, "Look, can't you get a job or anything like that?" And he said, "There's just no jobs." And you see them all over the city, you know, and I don't know what's going on. I've never seen it like that before. It's it seems to be the people that are down and out, it's going to be going further down, you know. And when you see kids on the street like that, you know, it's a bit stressful. But yeah, I would love, to answer your question, I would love to be able to do that, to work. And I actually scored a job with Justice, Juvenile Justice. And Ian said it, I was pretty shattered when I got this job, went and saw the minister. And he said, look, he said, these kids, tough kids, they're walking all over these young uni students graduating, coming out and taking the job of looking after the kids, and the kids are walking all over. And he said, we would love someone like you with your background to be able to do something about it, and we'll give you the job. And plus, I could teach them read and write. I'd done a course on that. So I got the job at Coimbra, and when I went down to get it, they just kept refusing to give it to me, and I found out later the local magistrate had found out I had the job, and just said no, he's not going to work with any of my children. So her children, she was just basically sent them back to jail. Now Ian can verify that, you were actually, you know that happened. That was one of the catalysts that sent me over the bend, really, because it left me without a job when I actually had a job, you know.
John, what year was that?
That was 1998, yeah. And I got into trouble in January 99. But the thing is, I think I'd be good working with kids, because I wouldn't cop any nonsense from them. And I'd tell them the way it is, and I'd tell them, look, if you want to finish up doing 30 years in jail, which is what I've done, this is the way to go. But if you don't, if you want to learn, if you want to stay out of trouble, then I can help you. And I really think that most of these kids can be helped. I'm a great believer. I'm a great believer.
Well, thank you to John,
to Bob,
to Ian, and if you want to buy some books,
They are right up here, and you can read the man's will from the horse's mouth.